Bibliophiles of the internet, I am back, and today I'm here to recap my favorite books from April. Before we get into that, let me just ask that you please be patient with me as I get back into the swing of things. Like I said in my last update, I'm not in a place where I can be making super long videos, so I'm trying to keep it concise, trying to put out whatever I can as I'm able to. So yeah, your continued patience and support is very greatly appreciated. So I read 15 books in April, which is why I can't talk about all of them in one video as much as I might want to. But to start, I will give you a brief overview of what I read. In April, I read Ana María and the Fox by Liana de la Rosa, Hestia Strikes a Match by Christine Grillo, The Beautiful Something Else by Ashvan Otterloo, Several People Are Typing by Calvin Kasulke, The Murder of Mr. Wickham and the Late Mrs. Willoughby by Claudia Gray, Promises of Gold by José Olivarez, Por Siempre by José Olivarez and Antonio Salazar, Nettle and Bone by T. Kingfisher, Warrior Girl Unearthed by Angeline Bulley, Dead Collections by Isaac Fellman, Sing Her Down by Ivy Pachota, The Furrows by Namwani Serpell, Gideon the Ninth by Tamsin Muir, and Ice Upon a Pier by Lads. Now let's get into the greatest hits. As I said before, I'm keeping this pretty abbreviated, so you can expect like an elevator pitch, content warnings, general thoughts, and then we just keep it moving from there. The first book I absolutely adored in April was Ana María and the Fox by Liana de la Rosa, which I read as an ARC at the time but came out from Berkeley on April 4th. This is historical romance set during the Victorian era, and it's about a sort of forbidden romance between an African-descended politician and a beautiful Mexican heiress. The titular character Ana María has been whisked away to London from Mexico because of the ongoing French occupation. Her father's also a very powerful Mexican politician, so she and her sisters have to navigate their first London season by keeping their heads down and comporting themselves with grace so as to win British sympathy for their cause. But of course, falling for a newly minted member of Parliament was never in the plans. Content warnings for explorations of slavery and colonization, instances of death, kidnapping, experiences of racism, colorism, and xenophobia, and some explicit sexual content. This is not only one of my favorite romances I've read this year, but just one of my favorite romances, period. It's beautifully written, it's lush, it's sweeping, it's populated by incredibly endearing characters, everything you want a romance set during this time period to be, and it also meaningfully engages with its historical context. It's not like Bridgerton, where characters of color are just swapped in and virtually everything else about the time period and setting remains virtually unchanged, but it actually explores what it was like to be a person of color navigating high society and having to meet these impossible expectations. That's why I love the connection between Ana María and Gideon so much. Not only do they have such natural chemistry and a great slow burn dynamic, but they connect on that level of having to be hyper visible in high society and maintain a good image for themselves at great personal cost. So it has those classic themes of duty warring with desire that you really want from a good historical romance, but there's also added nuance when it comes to how duty is compounded by culture, legacy, familial obligation, and all these different things. The pacing of the romance was a little bit off for me towards the end because they go from 0 to 60 pretty quickly, in my opinion, but I still loved this. There are side characters I cannot wait to see come back in subsequent books and get their own happily ever afters as well. Reading this just brought so much warmth and joy to my heart. It was great. I gave it 4.5 stars. My next April standout was The Beautiful Something Else by Ashvan Otterloo, which came out in May, but again, at the time I read it as an ARC courtesy of Scholastic. This is such an incredible contemporary queer middle grade story. It's about Sparrow discovering their non-binary identity after their mom's mental health takes a turn and they're sent to live with their aunt on a sprawling estate full of interesting, colorful new neighbors, friends, and experiences. Content warnings for experiences of misgendering, dead naming, and dysphoria, allusions to drug abuse, child abuse, and past alcoholism, instances of bullying and homophobia, and a brief mention of vomit. It's also worth noting that Sparrow is non-binary and queer, Sparrow's aunt is trans, their best friends are queer, and one is dyslexic, and Sparrow is also coded as neurodivergent. I read this book my first night after having surgery. I had to stay awake throughout the entire night pretty much because I was on a very tight rotation of meds, and this book kept me company the entire time. I finished it in a few hours, and by the end I was just a sobbing mess. But they were very good tears. By the end, I just felt this cathartic release of emotion because reading this felt very healing for my inner non-binary child. There were things in this book that I still needed to hear as a non-binary adult. This story really tackles those connotations of shame, wrongness and stigma that get attached to queerness. It tackles how morality and moral value is all too often falsely equated with queerness, which is something that keeps Sparrow very deeply closeted within themselves. There's also a sort of magical, fabulous element in the story when Sparrow's shadow takes on a life of its own and is sort of pushing them to do things that really scare them, the things they've been depriving themselves of for the sake of their mom's condition. And I thought that was a really smart and effective mechanic. I think the book beautifully balances grief, sadness, and fear with healing, discovery, and joy. So while it hits on all these different and at times difficult emotions, it is still very firmly seated in hopefulness. I actually wrote like a mini blurb for this book as a feature for Books Forward on Instagram, and I'm just gonna read it because it really says everything I want to say. Yes, this story is about Sparrow coming into their non-binary identity, but it's also about working through trauma and learning to move towards the kinds of beauty and safety that prevail beyond its confines. This is very much a story about the transition between surviving and living, and how growing into exactly who you are will always be a journey worth taking. 5 stars. Next, we have Several People Are Typing by Calvin Kasulke. To quote this book's own tagline, it is a work-from-home comedy where WFH meets WTF. It's one of those satirical, bizarre stories that really makes a meal out of unconventional formats. The story is told entirely through Slack messages, and it's about this mid-level employee named Gerald who basically gets sucked into Slack while Slackbot then attempts to pilot his human body and take over his life. Also worth noting that while this isn't necessarily a trans book, it is written by a trans author and has transness all over it, even though it's not explicitly about trans identity in any sense. There's actually an episode on the Gender Reveal podcast where the author is interviewed and talks more about that and about a lot of great stuff regarding this book, so I highly recommend checking that out. Content warnings for some mentions of animal death and brief allusions to sexual content. This is a book you need to read if you are done with corporate America's bullshit, if you want a story that understands what it means to be chronically online, and if you want a hysterical and thoughtful take on AI's piss-poor imitation of humanity and how the outlook of that particular future really sucks. This story is absurdist to the extreme, and I love it for that, because life itself, especially at this particular junction in history, is absurd more often than not. I love the format of this story as Slack messages. It's super accessible, personable, easy to read, and that format plays into how so much of our interactions occur online, so it draws the focus towards the growing tension between the online and offline worlds, as well as the shrinking disparity between the two. But what I appreciate most about this, I think, is that it doesn't cast all technology as evil, which I think would be the easy stance to take. It's playing with speculative elements to show many of technology's pitfalls, but it's also showing how part of being a human in the modern world is using technology as a means to cope with how bizarre this world is, and how we use it to try and forge meaningful connections with other humans who are also trying and failing to make sense of this wildly horrendous and impossibly wonderful existence that we all share, whether we like it or not. In the end, this is just an incredibly smart, funny, arrestingly original story that's somehow able to be minimalist and thought-provoking at the same time. It tackles everything from trauma bonding with coworkers to compulsive normality to what it means to even have a body, and I loved it. 4.5 stars, highly recommend this. Then, to no one's surprise, I adored Nettle and Bone by T. Kingfisher, which I actually listened to as an audiobook read by Amara Jasper. This is a dark twist on a classic fairy tale. It's about a princess and a prince, but the princess does not want to marry the prince, she wants to kill the prince. Content warnings for death and child death, references to miscarriage and grief, allusions to marital abuse, instances of child abuse, references to past suicide attempts, and some graphic injury and violence. T. Kingfisher is a once-in-a-lifetime author, in my opinion. Her take on fantasy and dark fantasy is so unique because she's able to be referential but also bring completely new ideas to the table, and she has this incredibly distinctive perspective and voice. Somehow this story is able to be as dark as it is adventurous. It's a fun take on a classic quest fantasy story, but it also pulls no punches when it comes to the grim circumstances the characters have to face. I'm a very simple person. If I find a story about a ragtag found family defying the odds and doggedly pursuing their own form of justice in a deeply unjust world and fighting for freedom no matter the cost, that will always be my jam. 10 times out of 10. And if there's a dog companion made out of bones and a demon chicken and a slow burn side romance with a bodyguard-like dynamic, well, that's just a bonus. Fairy tales have been told and retold hundreds and thousands of times across the world, across cultures, and just the fact that Kingfisher is able to bring something new and wildly memorable to that storytelling tradition is an incredible accomplishment. This was a very clear 5 stars. Next up, we have to talk about Warrior Girl Unearthed by Angeline Bouley, which I read for Color Pages blog tours, and I was gifted a finished copy for that tour by Fierce Reads. This story follows Perry, Firekeeper Birch, rebel and slacker extraordinaire, whose dreams of a laid-back summer go up in smoke when she totals her car and has to take an internship with the tribal council to pay for the repairs, which were covered by her auntie Donis. And through that internship, she learns about this ancestor known as Warrior Girl, whose remains are being held at a local university. So together with some of her fellow misfit interns, Perry decides that a good old-fashioned heist might be the only way to bring back the stolen artifacts and remains for good. Content warnings for experienced racism, mentions of rape, murder, and abduction, references to indigenous boarding schools and related trauma, and some references to grooming and predatory adults. I love what Angeline Bouley is doing in the contemporary YA space. She's telling these amazing Anishinaabe stories that are both modern and traditional, and she's carving out this space for indigenous mystery crime thriller novels for young audiences that is just fantastic. This story is so many different things at once, and I deeply appreciate it for that. It's somehow both a classic coming-of-age, one life-changing summer YA story where Perry's going through this internship and learning all these different things, while also building up to this really intense, really satisfying heist. And I think also on some level it's also decolonizing our concept of what a heist even means. But just like Angeline's first book, this story is also shedding light on the oxymoronic, lawful injustices that indigenous communities continue to face. In this story, Perry's learning about NAGPRA, which is federal law that allows indigenous nations to claim and repatriate stolen items and remains, but only if they follow a very strict set of designated steps under certain conditions. Like many laws that are meant to quote-unquote protect indigenous peoples, there's also an incredible amount of ways that these laws can be avoided or abused by colonizers to leave those same communities vulnerable to attack and loss. And the story also connects the violence of grave robbing with the ongoing violence against missing and murdered indigenous peoples, showing how indigenous peoples are considered to be as expendable as their history and their artifacts. And the author is able to weave all of that history, research, and awareness into the narrative in a way that feels seamless, in a way that complements and heightens the plot in a really effective way. When coupled with Perry's character growth as she learns about the importance of intentionality, community care, healing, and recognizing when to fight and how to fight in order to make the most impact, it just makes for an incredibly dynamic story. I gave this a huge 4.5 stars. Lastly, we're going to talk about Dead Collections by Isaac Fellman. I highly recommend the audiobook, which I listened to and is read by Danny Martinek. This is a contemporary adult story with some slight paranormal or speculative elements. It's about Sol, who's a trans archivist and also lives with an illness known as vampirism, and because he has to hide from the sun, he secretly lives at work in the archives. When this eccentric widow of a famous TV writer brings in her wife's work to be archived, there's an instant spark and the two of them get drawn into this weird existential romance. Content warnings for transphobia and TERF rhetoric, dead naming, descriptions of dysphoria and dissociation, references to infidelity, references to suicide ideation, brief descriptions of physical violence, some instances of fetishization, and explicit sexual content. Also worth noting, Sol is a Jewish trans man and Else is gender fluid. They are in a T-for-T relationship. I will say this, this book is not for everyone, but it sure as fuck is for me. It's another prime example of perfectly weird trans fiction that pieces together all these seemingly unrelated random ideas in order to closely examine what it means to be human, what it means to belong, and what it means to exist. Much like an archive, transness is this messy and disorderly jumble of information that we have to process in order to make sense of ourselves. It's about that tension between the illusion of control and all the things in life that we actually cannot control, and what happens when we find ourselves falling outside of those seemingly clean-cut boundaries. With Sol's vampirism, I think the story also speaks to a pervasive sense of placelessness that queer and trans people often experience in a world that was not built for us to exist in, and the paranoia that often follows our every step when the messages that we are unwanted or unnatural get continually reinforced. At its heart, this story is about two disaster trans characters reaching out to each other across the darkness and hoping against hope to find a sense of belonging in a world that has discarded them because of their identities, their age, their health status, their circumstances. And I think what makes that storyline really work is the writing itself. It's voicey, it's full of personality, cadence, passion, romance, and insight. It's able to pinpoint these really niche facets of existence in this sort of ambling, untethered, roundabout way that somehow incredibly sharp and smart. To put it very simply, this is a story about how life goes on, even as it disintegrates, even as we can't make sense of it, even when we lose ourselves in the not knowing. It's about learning to let go and allowing ourselves to be seen as our deeply imperfect, ungovernable, inexplicable selves. Again, this might be for a very specific audience, but I am, in fact, part of that audience. I gave this 5 stars. Now, I do want to mention that Gideon the Ninth was definitely a standout book for me in April. I've actually caught up on the entire series so far, and I love it. But I think in the future I'd like to do a should you read type of video for the series, which is much more specific and in-depth than what I'm doing in this format, so I think I'm gonna hold off on that for the moment. But just know that it was definitely a fave. So those are all the standout books I read in April, not to discredit all the other really wonderful books I read that month. But yeah, let me know if you've read any of these. Feel free to ask about any of the others I mentioned. If you're curious, tell me what you're reading lately. Tell me all the things down below in the comments. But that is everything I had to share for today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.